A microcontroller or MCU is an electronic component which is very common to find in everyday electronics. Actually, it is as common as transistors were in 20th century. You can find them inside TV, its remote, decoration lights, bike, car. They are literally everywhere. A typical home in a developed country is likely to have only 4 general purpose microprocessors, but about 3 dozen microcontrollers. In very simple words, a microcontroller is an integrated circuit used as a control device which incorporates at least one microprocessor or the CPU along with RAM, ROM, clock, timers, and I/O peripherals. Some microcontrollers also include hardware for analog signal processing, and they are known as mixed signal processors, like Texas Instruments MSC430 series. The whole idea behind the creation of microcontroller is to fabricate a monolithic device which may include all the necessary requirements for operating a microprocessor and which can be used for narrow applications, mainly for the fast closed loop control systems, for which the expensive setup of microprocessor with external ICs is just overkill. Some microcontrollers also have special hardware for digital signal processing like C2000 from Texas Instruments, which facilitates fast math operations needed for algorithms like FFT. Now let's take a deeper look at the individual parts of a microcontroller. The brain of the MCU is the processor itself, and it can be of two types, RISC or CISC. RISC stands for Reduced Instruction Set Computer, and CISC stands for Complex Instruction Set Computer. Although the instructions are decided by the manufacturer, CISC architecture provides a large number of complex instructions, while the RISC architecture provides a small number of simple instructions. ATMEL AVR is based on RISC architecture, like ATMEGA328P and ATMEGA16 uses RISC architecture that are present on Arduino Uno board. Intel's MCS51 family is based on CISC architecture. The formation of RISC architecture is a great example of Pareto principle, or the 80-20 rule, which states that for many events, roughly 80% of the effect comes from the 20% of the causes. In a microprocessor, about 80% of the instructions are generated and only 20% of the instruction set is executed. That is, by simplifying the instructions, the performance of the processor can be increased drastically, which led to the formation of RISC, that is Reduced Instruction Set Computer. Memory used in the microcontroller can be divided into two main types, program memory and data memory. Program memory is non-volatile memory, meaning it retains the data even after the power is removed, like flash memory. Data memory can be either volatile, like RAM, and non-volatile like EEPROM. We have different types of RAM and ROM available for our MCU. Some of them are better than others and some are even deprecated now. Have a look at different types of memory we use within MCU. Processor and memory can be connected to each other using two different architectures known as the Harvard architecture and the von Neumann or Princeton architecture. Harvard architecture uses two separate and isolated pairs of address and data bus, one for the program memory and one for the data memory. Whereas von Neumann architecture rely on one pair of address and data bus, the clock is like the heart. It creates a pulse for the processor, thus helping in the execution of instructions within the MCU. We generally use external crystal oscillators for generating the clock signal, and the circuitry for signal amplification and manipulation is present on the MCU itself. We must choose the crystal frequency that does not complicate our serial communication baud rate, like the weird 11.0592 MHz crystal is used with 8051 MCU just to keep the serial communication stable. For precise timekeeping, our MCU contains logic circuits known as timers and counters. A single microcontroller may contain several different timers and counters. Input-output peripherals include general-purpose input-output ports, serial communication ports, parallel ports, programming interface, and many more. A single microcontroller can cost more to fabricate than a microprocessor due to its die size and complexity, but the overall cost of a microcontroller is lower than the microprocessor setup with external chips. Various companies provide microcontroller chips. They usually have their own architecture, like AVR from Atmel and PIC from Microchip. Some of the microcontroller companies are listed here on the screen. The earliest known microcontroller or computer on a chip is developed in 1971 by TI engineers Gary Boone and Michael Cochrane. The result of their work was a TMS-1000, which became commercially available in 1974. Microcontrollers nowadays offer so many useful functionalities like ADC and DAC that are crucial for real-world applications. ADC converts the analog signal into digital signals, and the DAC does the opposite of it. Microcontrollers from Espressif like ESP8266 offer Wi-Fi, and ESP32 offers Bluetooth and Wi-Fi on a single chip. The microcontroller in itself is a very huge topic of embedded electronics, and it is impossible to convey everything in a single video like this. But let's just summarize what we have learned so far. A microcontroller is simply a computer on a chip with one or more microprocessor cores connected to some amount of RAM, ROM, timers, counters, ADC, DAC, input-output peripherals, wireless connectivity, and analog circuitry like comparators and amplifiers. Some common examples of microcontrollers include AVR from Atmel, PIC from Microchip, STM32 from STMicroelectronics, ESP32 from Espressif, MCS51 family from Intel, which is now produced by various other vendors also. The microcontroller is used in cameras, mobile phones, TVs, washing machines, space shuttles, laptops, toys, International Space Station. Actually, pretty much everything is controlled using microcontrollers these days. They can be bought for as little as 3 cents a piece and can be packed in packages smaller than a grain of rice. The microcontroller is literally the world-changing component. It will continue to change our life with new, cheaper, faster, and power-efficient designs. But it will change our life only if we manage to survive in this game of our own destruction. For protecting our world, I want you to take an initiative. I want everyone watching this video to properly dispose all of your old and unused electronic gadgets. Please do not litter them around. They cause serious damage to nature. I hope you are intelligent enough to follow and spread my words. It is for the betterment of humanity itself. Actually, we are the one who started this, and we have to end this by ourselves. I encourage you to get up and plant more and more trees around you. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you learned something new. Stay curious. Peace.